437, let's turn in our hymnal, if you can see, 437, since the Savior found me, pardon all my sin, let's all stand together, I'm saved, 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 since the Savior found me, pardon all my sin, I have had the joy and living hope within, gone is all the shame and sorrow of the past, there underneath the precious blood of Christ at last. Save, 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 I'm happy all the way. Save, 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 I love him more each day. I'm save, 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 I know he's mine, he's our. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his power. Since the Savior found me, all to him I owe. For his precious blood has washed me white as snow. Now no condemnation, happy as can be. I'm glad that Jesus justified and set me free. I'm saved, 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 I'm happy all the way. Saved, 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 I know he's mighty charm. By his power, since the Savior found me, I have perfect rest, living in the realms of joy and happiness, leaning on my Savior, looking for that day when he shall come to catch his waiting bride away. I'm saved, 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 I'm happy on the way. Saved, 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 I love him more each day. Save, 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 I know his mighty charm. He saves and keeps and sanctifies me by his power.
All right, that's good. It's good to see you in church tonight. Old-fashioned Sunday night. Now, I know if we were real old-fashioned, you wouldn't even have lights probably, and we wouldn't have a microphone, but we're not going to be that old-fashioned, all right? And we like the microphones, and a little bit of light will help us, and it's good to see you here this evening. Looking forward to a great service together tonight, all right? Let's start with a word of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we bow before you in prayer now this evening. We thank you, Lord, for another Sunday night you brought us to. And Lord, we bow before you here at the beginning of our service, and we ask you to meet with us this evening. We're a needy people. And Lord, we want you to be in charge of our service tonight, and meet the needs of the hearts of people here this evening. Lord, only you can do that. And so we ask you to help us. And we're thankful for the old-time religion, thankful for an old-fashioned church. And I pray, Lord, we'll leave in a little bit, saying it sure was good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Meet with us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you be seated. We have, who do we have? We have the famous Backwood Brothers Quartet, not Blackwood, Backwood, okay? And these guys, they don't know what practice is. They're just going to come up and sing it. They have a golden album with one song on it, All Fly Away, okay? And they're going to sing. Who's singing?
Are you coming? There we go.
Okay, yep, we got one more. No, we have a fourth member of the quartet here. How many are here? Three? I've got one more. Brother Charlie, come on up. You're going to like this. You're going to like this. Brother Charles Angeli going to sing. I heard somebody told me this guy can let her fly. All right? So we're going to find that out here when they sing All Fly Away. All right, Backwood Brothers, I'll turn it over to you.
If I feel led, I'll jump in.
Get a mic.
You don't sing with him very often?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Here we go. Right there.
Jump in. Can you see that? You don't need the words, do you?
No.
Okay.
There you go. Tear it up.
All right. Do this.
No, I got this right here.
All right through. Here we go.
Let's go.
Yep.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'm on my way to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by.
Let's go to 272 in our hymnal. 272. Once I drifted down in sin, had no hope nor joy within. Now I'm on the winning side. On that first together. Once I drifted down in sin, had no hope nor joy within. And my soul was burdened down with pride. Then my Savior came along, and he showed me I was wrong. Now I know I'm on the winning side. Well, I'm on the winning side. Yes, I'm on the winning side. Out in sin, no more will I abide. I've enlisted in the fight for the cause of truth and right. Praise the Lord, I'm on the winning side. From the straight and narrow way, I was drifting every day. Out upon the waters deep and wide. But it all is over now. Glory light was on my brow. And my soul is on the paths of truth and right. Praise the Lord, I'm on the winning side. I will never have a fear, for my Lord is ever near, and in Him so often I confide. He's a keeper of my soul, since I gave Him full control, and He placed me on the winning side. Well, I'm on the winning side, yes, I'm on the winning side. Out in sin, no more will I abide. I've enlisted in the fight for the cause of truth and right. Praise the Lord, I'm on the winning side. Let's do that chorus one more time without the piano. Well, I'm on the winning side. Yes, I'm on the winning side. Out of sin, no more will I abide. I've enlisted in the fight for the cause of truth and right. Praise the Lord, I'm on the winning side.
Amen. Good singing tonight. Now, just a few announcements. Regular schedule this week, Tuesday night for the Grove City School of the Bible, 7 o'clock in the Fellowship Hall. Wednesday night, midweek service right back here at 7 p.m. Children's clubs will meet, of course, on Wednesday night in the nursery, and then, of course, we'll be here in the auditorium continuing our study on the armor of God, doing the spiritual warfare. And the breastplate of righteousness will be Wednesday night. And then, remember, Friday night, RU, 7 o'clock, right here in the auditorium. Saturday morning at 10 o'clock for the bus visitation and the soul winning times. Also, those of you who are going to go to the baby shower for Melinda, if you would make sure you sign up in the foyer. There's a sheet down there. I think that's to help prepare the food and know what they can expect for that. That's coming this Saturday, all right? So make sure you sign up, ladies, at the conclusion service tonight. And ladies, those of you who are wearing borrowed hats, make sure you return those. Just going to put them on a table in the fellowship hall. Is that the way idea, Diane? Okay. If you do that, she would appreciate that. And I think we're good to go. All right. Let's take just a minute. Anybody here tonight for the first time? Looking around, I don't think I saw anybody. All right. Let's hear from the choir.
495. Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. 495. Let's sing that first together. Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One come down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Brethren, see poor sinners round you slumbering on the brink of woe. Death is coming, hell is moving. Can you bear to let them go? See our fathers and our mothers and our children sinking down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Sisters, will you join and help us? Moses' sister hated him. Will you help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin? Tell them all about our Savior. Tell them that he will be found. Sisters, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then he'll call us home to heaven. At his table we'll sit down. Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around. Amen. That's good. Let's go to the front of your book, number 3, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me. Would you stand with me as we sing? Amazing Grace. On that first together. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Thank you. Through many dangers, toils, and snares on that third. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Let's sing that first verse one more time. Let's sing that a cappella all together, all right? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind.
Seated, if you will. Here they come. You are going to get to be part of the hallelujah offering, okay? You don't know what that is, you're going to find out, okay? We have four young, leather-lunged young men here. That's the qualification. Now, Xavier, this is your second year at this, so we expect improvement over this, all right? And I think we gave you a mic last year, I think. And we expect him to improve. Here's how we do it. When there's a dollar put in the plate, then that's amen, okay? So when everybody puts a dollar in, it's amen. Now we'll practice and see how you do, okay? All right, Brother Brett.
Amen.
Oh my. We can do better than that. Here we go, Xavier. You ready, brother?
Amen.
Oh. He hasn't been practicing.
Show him how it's done. We're going to get the hang of it. Now, a $5 bill, let's see, a $5 bill is hallelujah, that's it, hallelujah. $5 bill is hallelujah, all right? Okay, Brother Brett, let's try. Ready?
Hallelujah!
All right, $1 bill is $5 bill.
Hallelujah!
A $10 bill is praise the Lord. Okay? Praise the Lord. David, you ready for this? Come on.
Praise the Lord.
All right, McKeon, let's hear it. Here we go.
Praise the Lord.
Lindy, you got to teach him how to yell, okay? Your wife's louder than you are, brother. I hate to tell you that, but you can do better than that. I know you can. Cut loose. Now, when somebody puts a $20 bill in, it's glory to God. Glory to God. Okay? All right?
Woo! Glory to God!
All right. Now, you say, well, what if it's a $100 bill? Well, you can do 100 amens. You can do 20 hallelujahs. You can do 10 praise the Lords, or you can do 5 glory to Gods. Okay? But every time that plate comes to your to you at the end of the row, you have to announce what's in there. Okay, how much was put in from the last time? Not all over again, but okay. And so get your offering out, get it ready to go. And these men will let you know how we're doing in the offering, okay? How by the amens, the praise of the Lords, the hallelujahs, and the glory to God's that you hear, okay? All right. Let's see. We'll have some to get you started here. All right. Father, bless this offering tonight. Thank you for the privilege that's ours to give. And Lord, I pray that if you, as the scriptures say, you loveth a cheerful giver, we certainly will give cheerfully tonight. And I pray you'll bless the offering to take care of the needs of your work in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, here we go. All right. Give those guys a hand, will you? Good job, fellas. I have no idea if you can see your Bibles or not. If you can see your Bible, go ahead and open it to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4. We're going to read verse 31. Starting in Acts 4, and we're going to read through Acts 5 and verse 11. So Acts 4, starting with verse 31, going through Acts 5 and verse number 11. And we'll read them responsively as we normally do. And also as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 31 of Acts chapter 4. Ready? And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God with boldness. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own. But they had all things common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them, and brought the prices of the things that were sold, and laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. And Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted, the son of consolation, a Levite, and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. But a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira his wife, sold a possession, and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Whiles it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down, and gave up the ghost. And great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out, and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after, when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, Tell me whether ye sold the land for so much. And she said, Yea, for so much. Then Peter said unto her, How is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them that have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry thee out. Then fell she down straightway at his feet, and yielded up the ghost. And the young men came in, and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband. And let's end with reading verse 11 also. And great fear came upon all the church, and upon as many as heard these things. And let's pray. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture now tonight. And Lord, we enjoy the old-fashioned day and putting our stamp of approval on the old-time religion. Lord, there's much that is being passed off today and by way of Christianity that is far, far away from Bible Christianity. And Lord, I pray that this evening you would help us to look again at the church and understand your blessing upon the early church. And Lord, that's our pattern. That's what we would like to be. And I pray, Lord, that we would not be concerned about the 21st century church as much as we would be the first century church. And so, Father, I pray you'll prepare our hearts to make us ready to receive your word this evening. Lord, bless the special to that end. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore, Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love, and power. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms. Come ye thirsty, come and welcome God's free bounty, glorify true belief and true repentance, every grace that brings you nigh. Come, ye weary, heavy laden, lost and ruined by the fall. If you tarry till you're better, you will never come at all. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms. Let not conscience make you linger, nor a fitness fondly dream. All the fitness he requireth is to fill your need of him. I must arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
It's good. Our Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer now this evening and thank you, Lord, for what we've seen and heard here tonight. Lord, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. Thank you for each one that's been faithful to be in their place here this evening. Father, we're asking that you would meet with us now tonight and that you would open our understanding as we look into your word. I pray you'll help me as I bring this message tonight, and please help everyone to listen carefully, not be distracted. And Lord, I pray that your will would be accomplished in each one of our hearts and lives. Lord, I'll thank you now in advance for what I believe you'll do here in our midst this evening. Help us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Sunday is a very important day in the New Testament church and for the Christian. Jesus, of course, was resurrected on a Sunday. That's why we meet on Sunday. We no longer have a Sabbath day. And Sunday is not a Sabbath. Sunday is, as the Bible terms it, it's the Lord's day. It's the first day of the week. Your day doesn't start Monday morning. Your week started this morning. And that's why the first day of the week, when the Bible speaks of that, it's talking about the Lord's day. It is His day. I remember when America honored Sunday. I remember when, just as a boy, I remember you, if you didn't have it, you didn't get it on Sunday. There wasn't a store open to get it in, and you just waited till Monday when the stores would open again. Now it seems like it's just another day of the week. In fact, it's almost just like a second Saturday to those without God, and sadly, to some even with God, the days of the week would go Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Saturday, Monday. There's no Sunday to it. There's no Lord's Day to it, certainly. It's just another day to get the yard work done, or another day to wash the car, or another day to go shopping, or another day to catch up on home repairs, whatever it may be. It's a day when most businesses now are open on Sunday and open for business, and people do everything they can imagine. But I believe that as a believer, as a Christian, that Sunday ought to be the Lord's Day. And I believe when the church house doors are open, a Christian ought to be in church. I think when the church house doors are open, a Christian ought to be in church. That's Sunday morning and Sunday night on Sunday. And I realize sometimes you're providentially hindered from coming, and some have employment that hinders them from being here. But I believe you ought to be in church when the doors are open. You know, there's never a shortage of excuses for people who don't want to fulfill Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. Hebrews 10 and verse 25 says, "Not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is." Even in that day, there were some who would forsake the assembling of themselves together. And Paul addresses that in the book of Hebrews. He said, I want you to be exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. And yet it seems as if as we see the day approaching, which is the day that Christ will return for us, we seem to want to get together less rather than get together more. And so we understand how people were in that day, and we understand how they are in this day. You know, forsake there, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. That word forsake means to desert, to abandon, or leave behind. There are many people who have abandoned the church. Many people who have abandoned their area of service in the church. Many people will eventually, by the way, you don't just abandon the church before you'll eventually abandon the Lord. There's a progression, and I'll show you that in just a minute. But that's a in the book of Acts. How many? If I said the name Eutychus, how many know who I'm talking about? Eutychus. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, under 10. Eutychus was a young man who was in church, and he was in church, and it was a Sunday night church. Now, how many remember who Eutychus might be? Yeah, a few more. It's coming back to you now, isn't it? Cobwebs are getting dusted off. And Paul was preaching on a Sunday night, and the Bible says he was long preaching. I like Paul. And he was long preaching, and Eutychus was sitting up, and he was sitting up in the loft area, and he was leaning against a window, and he fell asleep. Well, he didn't just fall asleep, and he fell out, so to speak, and not charismatically speaking. He fell out the window and down to the floor because he was long. In fact, Paul continued his preaching till midnight. I assure you, I'll be done by 11:30. Yeah. At least he's honest. I'll say more about him in just a minute. Not the one who said, praise the Lord, the Eutychus. You know, there's a progression that we see with Eutychus, and this is just introduction. But I was thinking about him and how he ended up falling out of church, literally. And it started with dozing. For one reason or another, you know what you do when you doze? You've lost interest. You've just lost interest. You take the opportunity to assemble together for granted. You begin to get slack about your service for God in the church. You don't come out on visitation or soul winning. You start missing Wednesday nights. You start skipping Sunday school. Then pretty soon you stop Sunday nights. And before you know it, Sunday mornings will get sporadic. And then you wake up one day and you realize, we don't really go to church much anymore. That's how it happens. That's why it's such a concern when you first start missing and the pastor checks on you, wants to know where you are and encourages you to be faithful, because it happens that way. Nobody ever wakes up and says, I'm done, I'm not going anymore. It starts with dozing. Then comes what I call declining. And kind of, they're intertwined together. I'll tell you a statement that I don't like. I don't like the statement that says, well, I don't have to go to church to be a Christian. There's a spirit behind that statement that isn't a good spirit. Now, that is true. To be a Christian, to be saved and on your way to heaven, you don't have to go to church. Because to be a Christian, you have to know Christ as your Savior. But I'll guarantee you this. If you're going to be a good Christian, you have to go to church. If you're going to be a good Christian, you're going to go to church. If you're going to be a godly Christian, you're going to go to church. I have not seen in 34 years of pastoring churches, I have not seen somebody who's been effective and successfully living for God and bearing fruit for God who did not go to church. It doesn't exist. Now, we know from the Gospels that Jesus went to church. We know how important it was for him. Mary and Joseph took him when he was 8 days old to the temple. And then he regularly went there growing up. It talks about when he started his ministry, he went to the synagogue as his custom was. It was customized because mom and dad took him to church. Parents don't listen to the lie, well, I take my kid to church, I make him go. He won't want to go when he gets older. Or she won't want to go when they get older. That's a lie of the devil. Don't listen to people who say, well, I had that religion crammed down my throat when I was a kid, and now I'm not going when I get older. Well, I think they crammed brushing your teeth down your throat too. Did you still brush your teeth? They told you to clean and take a shower or take a bath. You probably still do that occasionally, don't you? There are other things that your parents taught you to do that you still do. And the reason you choose the house of God and not go to church is simply because your heart is wicked and you don't want to live for God, period. Let's just cut to the chase, amen? And just have to be honest about it. It's not because your parents did the right thing and got you to the house of God. And so I believe if it's important for Jesus, it probably ought to be important to us, don't you think? Thank you. Every one of us have loved ones, friends, or acquaintances who we know who say they're saved, but they don't go to church. They're out of church. You can look at their life, you remember where they once were, and you know where they are now. And you can see clearly the evidence of what happens when you start declining spiritually. It's a sad thing to see. After dozing and declining, you end up dying. When Eutychus fell out of that window, he was dead. They hit the ground and he was dead. Now Paul was there and he brought him back to life. Don't any of you try it. I'm not Paul. But it doesn't mean you lose your salvation, but you'll basically be dead spiritually. There's no life in you about the things of God. No life in you for the work of the Lord. You've gone from being a witness for Christ to being a stumbling block to others. Your witness is damaged. There's no joy in salvation. People, when they talk about hypocrites and people who say they're saved but don't live like it, they point at you. You're the one they're talking about. I hope you're not declining or dying tonight. If so, there'll be opportunity for you to make it right. You're not right with God and wrong with His church. You're not right with God and wrong with His church. An impossibility. And I thank God for people who you can depend on to be faithful. And that faithfulness is dependable. Faithfulness is you can count on it. You know, you wouldn't say you had a faithful car if it started one out every 3 mornings you went out to start your car. You would say, we've got to do something about this car. This isn't going to work going out there and once every 3 days it runs. You wouldn't accept that. Most of you would not have a job if you went one every 3 days you were scheduled to work. You wouldn't say to your employer, what's your problem, man? I come once every 3 days. Huh? But you don't seem to have a problem telling the Lord, well, I come once every 3 services. What's your problem? Boy, that's quiet. Ooh. Be faithful. Be faithful. I want to look at the early church in Jerusalem. And I'll just give you several points about this early church. As I said in the prayer, I believe, I'm not concerned about being a 21st century church. I am concerned about being a first century church. I think the pattern for a church is this first church in Jerusalem. This church and probably the church at Antioch were the 2 churches, and this one, particularly in the early days, which was not long after Jesus sent them to the upper room and then ascended up to heaven. And in the early months that followed, they say in 6 months' time or so, this church at Jerusalem could have grown to as many as 50,000 people. It's just pretty phenomenal. And so I want you to notice, first of all, the prosperity of the church. The prosperity of the church. In Acts chapter 2, and I don't know if you can see or not, but I'll read it for you. The Bible says in Acts 2 and verse 42, this is after Pentecost, and 3,000 souls were added unto them, that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. My friend, that's a prosperous church. Now, when I'm talking about prosperity, I'm not talking about name it and claim it and, you know, grab it and nab it type kind of stuff that makes it. That's, in fact, when you look up in a, there's an online encyclopedia called Wikipedia. Some of you might be familiar with that. When you look up the phrase word of faith, it says a movement within the Pentecostal and charismatic churches worldwide. Its central doctrine is that health and prosperity are promised to all believers and are available through faith. For this reason, it has also become known as the health and wealth and the gospel of greed. Although there are terms usually applied by those who are critical of it, other names reflecting major aspects of the movement include name it and claim it, the prosperity gospel, and positive confession. In other words, you just speak it and it'll come to pass. Okay? That's not biblical. Okay? I'm for being positive. I'm for being trying to stay on the top side of things. But listen, my friends, you don't just name it and claim it. The Bible says, ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. You have to ask, and you have not because you ask not. I'm not telling God. God doesn't answer my prayer based on my merit. He answers prayer based on His mercy. And He's merciful to all of us. Now, so I don't preach the prosperity of everybody ought to be healthy and wealthy. And I don't think the Bible teaches that. Number one, Jesus was not wealthy. In fact, the Son of Man had nowhere to lay His head. And no earthly possession at all. And then, and by the way, if it's health, the Apostle Paul didn't understand what that was. He had difficulties with his health. He had a physician travel with him. Luke traveled with him as a personal physician, I think, to help him with his health and to take care of him in his medical needs. He had a thorn in the flesh that bothered him. So I don't think that that's the issue, but I don't think that means Christians always have to be sorrowful and down in the mouth and, you know, wear sackcloth and ashes all the time. All right? I think you've been around long enough to know that we don't believe that here. This early church, hey, there was sorrow. There were disappointments. There were opposition. There were problems. But they had times of joy. And they had times of great victory. Here was one we read about at Pentecost where 3,000 were saved in one day. A little later on, 5,000 more were added to the church. And then later on, they didn't even add them. They said they multiplied them. They were just multiplied to the Lord. And the church grew. It was an exciting place to be. And Jesus, what Jesus said, and they were, these folks had remembered what Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And I can just picture those early Christians saying, man, this is just like Jesus said He'd do. This is just like He said would happen. Look at what's going on and look at the people being saved. In fact, the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Hey, I'm thrilled. And Dino here, he accepted Christ as Savior this morning. I'm thrilled about that. Praise the Lord for that. Listen, they saw people saved every single day of the week. And the Lord was adding to the church. I mean, how'd you like it if every day I got a phone call saying, Pastor so-and-so just got saved. I'm bringing them down to the church. Get the baptistry ready. Amen. Imagine that? And we'd people saved and baptized on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday and Sunday. What would it be like for a church to say, God's adding to our church daily such as should be saved? Wouldn't that be an incredible thing? That's the prosperity of the church. God had blessed them tremendously. But then we also something else begin to take place. And by the way, we see that prosperity when we verses we read tonight. At the end of chapter 4, they were filled with the Holy Ghost and they spake the word of God with boldness. And they were all of one heart and one soul, and none of them said that any of the things he possessed was his own. And by the way, none of the things we possess are our own. Whose are they? They belong to God. And so when somebody had a need, they gave to meet that need. And so none of them lacked. Some people began to sell lands or houses and brought it to the church, the disciples. They laid it at the disciples' feet, and they let the disciples distribute it according to who had the needs. And so as this is going on, they came into a peril, the peril of the church. That happens in chapter 5 and verse 1. Here's the peril. A certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and bought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Now remember, they're selling lands as houses, and they're taking that money and laying it at the apostles' feet. So they did the same thing. Only they didn't take the money and lay it at the apostles' feet. They took a certain part of the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. But let everybody else think it was the whole price. So they weren't honest about what they were giving. There's a problem here. And again, you go back to Acts chapter 2 and combine it with the end of Acts chapter 4, and you find out there had a... Look at verse 46 of Acts chapter 2. They ate their bread with gladness and the last three words of verse 46. Can anybody see them? Singleness of heart. Singleness of heart. Now there comes somebody in the church that doesn't have the singleness of heart. He doesn't have the same, they're not on the same page. The church had a concern for one another, and they had concern that the needs were met. And in the middle of the church's prosperity, in the middle of the blessings of God, in the middle of people being filled with the Holy Ghost, in the middle of souls being saved, and the Lord adding to the church daily, and the church growing, and the church prospering, right in the middle of that, peril comes. A problem arises. And the problem is not in the giving. It's in their heart. It's the heart behind the giving. That's where they didn't have a singleness of heart. If they'd have just been forthright, if they'd have just been honest about it and said, hey, we sold the land for this much, but we're giving this much, hey, that's fine. Nobody would have had a problem. They didn't. Nobody. There was no requirement that you had to give it all. And so they lied about it. And so we have the sad story recorded for us. In Acts chapter 5. They concocted a story together. They both were together on it. Making believe they were like everybody else. And they weren't. Making believe they had given all. And they hadn't. They didn't have singleness of heart. And so the prosperity of the church was interrupted. There was great turmoil here. Peril means exposure to risk. Peril means imminent danger. There was imminent danger here in the church. Because you understand that when Pentecost came and the Spirit of God came down and 3,000 were saved not one day, they were all with one accord in one place. There was great unity there. They continued with those 3,000 and they all had a singleness of heart, a singleness of purpose. And then they all said, well, none of the things we have are our own. We're going to sell what we need here. You distribute to the people who have needs. Oh, a oneness, a singleness of heart. And now that's disrupted. And God will not honor and God will not bless where there's disunity. Singleness of heart is gone. And when God's Spirit is grieved, He cannot move. When you have a singleness of heart, you can't come to church with a complaining spirit. You can't come to church with a critical spirit when there's a singleness of heart. You can always tell when someone's losing their singleness of heart, you know what, to become critical of things that normally wouldn't bother them. Normally it's not a big deal, and all of a sudden little things begin to get under them. And then you hear statements like, well, that's the straw that broke the camel's back? Why were you collecting straws? Why were you keeping score? Always looking at this and finding fault. You know, I remember coming back from early years in college, and I think I might have been one full year in college, because everybody knows after you go one full year to Bible college, you know everything. And that was me and some others. We came back, and Brother Brett, we sat in church, and boy, I tell you what, we just knew everything that Dr. Henniger was doing wrong. I mean, come on, he'd only pastored 35 years. We had 1 year of Bible college. We knew what was going on. Huh? Isn't that crazy? Huh? How ridiculous that a fellow who's been in the ministry many more years than we were old, and we think we know better how to pastor the church than he does. Isn't that an amazing thing? And I tell you what happens. The way to cure that is begin to pray for the pastor. And when you pray for him and you get prayed up, it's hard to be critical. You're praying for the leader. And that's how you get cured for that. Once you get prayed up, you shut up. I like that. Maybe that's why some people complain and criticize, because they're not prayed up. The danger when you complain and criticize, the danger, I think, when this singleness of heart had to be dealt with, was because you usually don't suffer that by yourself. You tell somebody else. And that disrupts what the Lord has in mind for His church. And I want you to notice what Peter said to Ananias. Look at verse 3. Peter said, "Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land?" Why is Satan, I'm not going to preach on that necessarily, but you understand, he said, you conceived it. In other, he said, you fulfilled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost. Could he have resisted the devil? Yes. Resist the devil, he'll flee from you. And so he could have said no. Remember what we said, anytime there's a sin in someone's life, you be guaranteed there's a lie there. There's a deception there, because Satan is a liar. And he could have said, "Satan, I'll have no part in this deception." And if there's deception involved, Satan's involved. If there's deception involved, Satan is involved. You don't have to be deceiving. And Peter didn't. But he didn't rebuke the devil. He rebuked Ananias. The devil isn't going to fill his heart. The devil isn't going to influence in that way unless Ananias allows him to. And he allowed him to. So he rebuked Ananias. Listen, don't you flip Wilson out and say, "Well, the devil made me do it," and think that's going to be a good excuse. It's not a good excuse. And it is no excuse for doing what's wrong. The buck didn't stop with the devil. The buck stopped with Ananias. And so he dealt with the peril. And of course, you know, God struck him dead. There carried him out of the church service. And then you notice about 3 hours later, his wife came in. I don't know why she was 3 hours late for church, but she was. Maybe she was getting her hair done. I don't know. I used to laugh. Phyllis Diller said, "I spent 3 hours at the beauty parlor," and that was just for the estimate. But maybe she was getting an estimate. I don't know. But she came in 3 hours. Hey, you know what the great thing was? 3 hours later, she showed up at church and they were still having church. Can you imagine that? You imagine if you had a church service for 3 hours long? Yeah, nobody said amen to that. Amen. We're not conditioned to that. But boy, we'll watch a football game for 3.5 hours, 4 hours, huh? Uh-oh. Sorry, got off preaching and went to meddling there. Just a minute. And of course, she dropped dead and they carried her out. The Bible says great fear came upon the church. I guess so. It would in any situation. So I see the prosperity of the church, the peril of the church, but then, of course, the punishment of the church, and that's what we've been referring to with them, God judging them. That's how serious God looks at folks who want to bring peril to his church. We minimize the church so much that we think it's no big deal. I got news for you. In God's eyes, it's a big deal. It's a big deal. And he'll protect his church. And here the outcome was the judgment of God upon Ananias and Sapphira. And he punished those in the church, not unlike he did in the Old Testament when they would murmur and complain against Moses. You remember the episode with Korah and his followers? And Korah criticized Moses, said, "Who made you the big cheese?" That's in the Hebrew. You got to dig deep for that. But the "Who made you the big boss? Who made you in charge? You take too much on you." And by the way, there's a parenthesis in that passage in Numbers 16. We don't have time to look there tonight, but you'd say it says that Moses was a meek man. In fact, I think it says he's the meekest man on the face of the earth. And that's a parenthesis. That's a personal note from the author to the reader. That's God telling us Moses was meek. So Moses didn't think of himself more highly than he ought to think. Moses wasn't making it difficult to get along with him. He wasn't that way at all. And so we know the problem was on Korah. And here's what Moses said, if you remember. He said, "Hey, if you guys die a natural death, if you live out your days and you die naturally, then God hasn't spoken anything by me. I'm a fraud. But if he makes some new thing, like the earth open up and swallow all you guys up, then you'll know that God has spoken by me." Wow. I mean, that's really putting something out there. You understand, this isn't the earth opening up and swallowing up people. That doesn't happen every day. Okay? Maybe more so in our day with all the sinkholes we see going on, but they didn't have those in that day, okay? And sure enough, you know the story. They met out there and God opened up the earth and it swallowed them up. Swallowed them up whole. God took seriously. And the Bible says that all they that appertained to Korah in them went down alive into the pit, and the earth closed upon them, and they perished from the congregation. You say, "Yeah, but Pastor, that was back under the law. We're under grace." Yeah, Acts 5 was under grace. God did the same thing. He killed them both. He judged them both. It's God is a God of love and God's a God of mercy, but God's also a God of judgment. And God will judge sin, my friend. Don't make the God of your mind. Make him the God of the Bible. And he is equal in all his attributes. "Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. The time has come, Peter said, that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel? And he and his wife experienced the judgment of God, the punishment of God. So I see the prosperity of this early church and the peril of the early church, the punishment of the early church. And let's see what happened after this took place and after they took him out and buried him. The progress of the church. Look at verse 14. Here's what happened. "And believers were the more added to the Lord." How many? Can you see the next word? "Multitudes, both of men and women. Insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least a shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. There came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed everyone." That's unbelievable. Once the peril was removed, progress came again. Progress came again. And they continued, as Acts says in chapter 2, "daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, and ate their meat with singleness and gladness of heart." No other plan, no other priority, no other purpose other than to see the church progress, to see God's work continue to go forward. That was all what they were all about. They weren't in it for selfish reasons. Think about this early church. They weren't in it to see what they could get out of it. This early church, they didn't come to see, "Well, let me see, Peter, what kind of programs do you have available for my children? They didn't come and see, what do you have for teenagers, and what do you have for singles, what do you have for couples, what do you have for widows? Boy, that's quiet. Have we become consumers when it comes to the church? Somebody spoke to me today and said they, at the church ladies at the retreat, they have a, what'd they call it? Couples? I can't remember now. I can't remember how they worded it. Couples and something else rhymed with couples. And then there was a third group that was just oddballs or something. I don't know what it was. And she said, why don't we have a class like that? I said, we do. It was our Sunday school time. I said, right here it is. We have couples. We have singles. We have widows. We have everybody. There's our Sunday school class. But you understand? Why is it that it's happened to us that we say, well, now I'd like to come to your church, but do you have a class for bald-headed, left-handed men over 55? That's about how bad it's gotten. You know, I want to make sure there's a class specially for me. Well, now I'm thinking about joining your church, but now you do have a gymnasium. You do have a basketball court. Or you do have a bowling alley or baseball leagues. Or do you have a cappuccino shop? What kind of coffee do you serve on Sunday morning? Is there donuts? That's where we've come to in our churches. Can you imagine the early church that would be a concern? I don't think they came in complaining that there weren't any bagels or the donuts weren't cream-filled or the music's too loud or there's not enough music or the church too hot or the church is too cold. The sermon's too long or the sermon's too short or so-and-so didn't sing this morning or so-and-so did sing this morning. They didn't come in habitually late. They didn't miss any services. And by the way, they didn't just come to be at church. They came to be in church. The hallway downstairs is for when you're sick or you don't want to come in and can be contagious to somebody or you're not feeling well in the service, but it's not a place to come hang out and say, well, I went to church. You're to be in church. And being at church and being in church are two different things. Be in church. They didn't not come to church because, well, the chariot races were on television or the World Series was happening. Or they had a hard day at the Jerusalem market or were plumb wore out. Or they had to get up at 4 a.m. to milk the goats and go fetch the water. I'd come, Paul, but I got an early morning tomorrow. No. Why? That is singleness of heart. That is singleness of heart to serve the Lord. They wanted to see the church progress. They wanted to see God's work go forward. That was their purpose of heart. And that brought unity. That brought the one mind and one accord. They came to praise and they came to serve. And by the way, the Bible says we're to serve the Lord with gladness. Used to be a day, and I remember, and listen, I'm not that old. If I got to pull it out of you, it doesn't work, all right? Prematurely gray, that's all it is. I remember when folks were excited to serve God. And excited about the things of God. And would make themselves available and be want to help and want to do something. And you say, oh, Pastor, I'm so busy. And listen, let me help you. If the devil can't make you sinful or make you wicked, he'll make you busy. Too busy to serve God. Too busy to do anything for the Lord. Monday night, you got to rest up from the weekend. And Tuesday night, there's ball games. And Wednesday night, you get home from work late. And Thursday night, well, that's my program on television. I can't miss that. And Friday night, well, everybody goes out to eat. Or we go to high school football game. And Saturday, well, that's the only day to get work done around the house, man. And Sunday, well, that's my day to rest. And we think it's a big sacrifice to even get to church on a Sunday morning. And boy, you're really asking a lot if you think I ought to come back on Sunday night. You wait. We'll come to this, and I'll have a message probably about it. Sunday, I got news for you. Sunday this year, Christmas Day is on Sunday. I was just asked when I was up home, I was up to see my mom. Her 90th birthday is October 29th. She lives another 13 days. She'll be 90 years young, and she's doing great. Went to dinner with her and had breakfast with her and spent some time talking to her. And, you know, in the course of that conversation with some other people there, the question was asked, I think it was there over at my daughter's, I don't remember which, well, what are you going to do about Christmas falling on Sunday? So what are you going to do with your services? Now, I'm not going to tell you how I answered. How many of you have been in this church for at least 5 years? Let me see your hand. Okay, pretty good percentage. What do you think I answered? Sunday school 9:30, morning service at 10:30, Sunday evening at 6:30. It's Sunday, man. It's Sunday. Sunday takes precedence over Christmas Day. It's Jesus, happy birthday, but I ain't got time for you. I'm not coming to your house. Think about that. What's happened to us? No singleness of heart. No singleness of heart. No time to prepare for a Sunday school class. No time to invite anybody else to come to church. No time to work for Jesus. No singleness of heart. I read this letter. It was written to Mr. Bear of Bear Aspirin. It said, Mr. Bear, you manufacture aspirin that relieves suffering, cold, and fever. The mixture used in your tablet makes it possible for a person to get out of bed and fight off headaches, muscle spasms, and bad nerves. I've noticed that these tablets work wonders all through the week and especially well on Saturdays. But the people who take them cannot get rid of their aches and pains and get out of bed to come to Sunday school and to church. Is it possible for you to put something in that pill that will work on Sundays too? Good question. Singleness of heart is becoming more and more rare across our country. And by the way, as we see that happening, and we see churches that are meeting less and less, and listen, demanding less and less of people, far less than what Jesus demands. So I'm not expecting of you, I'm not giving you expectations that are not based in the Word of God. I'm going to tell you what the Word of God, I have to tell you what God expects of you. That's my responsibility. I will give an account to God one day of whether I gave you what He gave for me to give to you. I want to be a faithful messenger. The services in this early church, I can imagine what they were like. People singing and preaching and testifying, and the Bible says they were serving the Lord with gladness. They were happy serving Christ. No wonder the church was growing. No wonder the church was advancing. No wonder souls were being saved. It wasn't just Peter and John fired up. It wasn't just the apostles fired up. Everybody was fired up. Everybody was excited about it. Everybody was actively involved in the church. It's an exciting time. Now let me close with this. I talked about the prosperity of the church, the peril of the church, the punishment of the church, the progress of the church. Here's the last one, the prize of the church. The Bible says that in Ephesians 5, verse 25, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and did what? Gave himself for it. Now listen, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, But it should be holy and without blemish. The whole purpose of Christ coming and Him saving you and me is, listen, He's going to present us to Himself one day as a bride. The prize is we get to be with Jesus. He says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. That's what the groom did when he proposed to his wife. He'd go back to his father's house and he'd begin to build. He'd build his addition onto his father's house. And his father would help as he could, but the son would do most of the work. And as he'd build and he would put things in place, that father would come in at least once a day and he'd inspect it. And the son would say, is it enough? Is it ready? And the father would say, not yet. And he'd have to work some more and build some more and finish some more and work some more. And he'd come in, is it ready yet? No, not yet. He couldn't go get his bride until the father said, okay, your room's ready. Go get your bride. And that's why the Bible talks about when there was a wedding invitation, you didn't know, you would accept the invitation, but you didn't know when the wedding was. Nowadays, when you get a wedding invitation, you know the date, the time, and all the time it's going to be. You plan for that. They just had to be ready, and the word would begin to spread. He's come for the bride. He's coming for the bride. And the entourage would begin to build, and folks would join in, and they'd all go to the wedding. There's coming a day when the Lord Jesus, by the way, He said, I've gone to prepare a place for you. That's what He's doing. He's building a place for the bride. He's waiting for the Father to say, okay, go get your bride. And the Lord Himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God. The dead in Christ are going to rise first. And we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the air to meet in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. What a day that'll be. Can I tell you something? If that happened on a Sunday night, boy, I want to be in church, wouldn't you? I'd want to be right in church. I want to be right where I ought to be and go right up from here. What a time. What a prize. What a great place, God. What a great thing God did when He said, I'm going to give you a church to belong to. I'm going to give you a church family to belong to. The pillar and ground of the truth, as we learned on Wednesday night. A place of fellowship and encouragement. A place of learning and discipleship. A place for service and for soul winning. Man, if He returned tonight, I'd want to be in church. This is where I'd want to be. And maybe tonight will be the night when the Lord will say, go get your bride. And we'll go. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon His face, the one who saved me by His grace. Oh, when He takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be. Father, we look forward to that day. And it's perfectly okay if it's tonight. Lord, we're ready to go. Lord, I pray that until You come, that we'll be found faithful. That, Lord, we'll be faithful to the church You gave us. We'll not ever underestimate the importance of the local church and its necessity in our life to be successful as Christians. Give us here at Bible Baptist Church that singleness of heart to move forward in the work of God and experience the higher ground that we desire for this year. Thank You for all You've done. Thank You for what You've yet to do in each of our lives and in the life of our church. Now, Lord, I pray that You've spoken to people's hearts tonight. I pray that none in this room, Lord, would be dozing or declining on the precipice of dying. Lord, I pray that if they are, that You would point it out in their heart and they'd bow the knee to You tonight and make it right. Lord, maybe others have lost their singleness of heart they would simply bow the knee and say, God, give me a love for your church like I ought to have for your church. And help me to be faithful. Help me to find my place of service. Help me to be an encouragement to others. Help me to learn and to continue in the doctrine and the fellowship with other believers. Lord, I pray that all of us together would have a gladness as we serve the Lord, a singleness of heart as we move forward for you. Now our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer and we'll have our invitation. But I wonder tonight how many believers would say, Preacher, the Lord has spoken to my heart this evening. In my relationship with the church, I don't know what area he pricked your heart in or he spoke to your heart, but you'd say tonight, Preacher, the Lord has dealt with me. I'm ready to respond to what he's told me to do in my heart tonight. Pastor, pray for me this evening. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Yes, yes, yes. Amen. God bless you. You may put them down. In a moment, we'll have our invitation. I'm telling you, folks, the greatest decision you'll ever make, one of the greatest decisions after salvation, is when you decide that I'm going to be faithful Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Sunrise east, sets in the west, 2 + 2 = 4, water runs downhill, I'll be in church when the doors are open. It will change your life for the better. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this evening. Father, thank you for this invitation. I pray your will be done now in the hearts and life of each individual. Thank you for speaking to hearts tonight. And I pray, Lord, now that you'll hear our prayers, we bend our knee to you. Lord, we look forward to the day when we can seize the prize of seeing you face to face and spending eternity with you, who loved us and gave himself for us. Please bless this invitation now, I pray, for Jesus' sake. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Please respond to him tonight.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. I surrender.
I surrender all.
Father, we thank you now for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for a wonderful day today in the house of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the salvation that Dino received this morning. Lord, I pray your blessing upon his life now. Give him a good week. Lord, help him to understand and continue to be able to grasp exactly what's taking place in his life. Lord, I pray that you would do great things with his life, Lord. We're asking you, Lord, for the other decisions that were made today. You'd seal them to our heart. You'd give us the help of the Holy Spirit to live out the decisions that we made today. We love you. We thank you, Lord, for what you have done at Bible Baptist Church and what you continue to do in this place. I pray we'll be faithful, and as we run our leg of the race, we'll be faithful to run until you call us home. We love you. We thank you for a great day today. Thank you for our church. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing that together. Let's hear you sing. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You're dismissed. Ladies, remember your hat.